Welcome to Sundays in Eberron. We're going to do recaps, and I'm going to continue setting up our OBS as we go, because we're a little late starting here today. So I want to make sure we have time to play and have fun and all that. So we're going to do recaps, and we're just going to go around in order of y'all's names. So on roll 20, we've got Kuven going first. Kuven, can you give us a recap, a minute or so of what's been going on lately?
Yeah, we are now going on a lightning rail on a trip, which he's not particularly happy about because we're going really, really close to the Mornland. So he's not really expressed that to anybody yet, but internally he's kind of battling that. And as we get closer, we'll see how it affects him. And I'll leave the details of the mission to some others. That way people can have things to talk about.
All right. Thank you. Next in order is Rathrin. What's going on? What happened last time or recently?
We escaped the laboratory that was making all those unforged creatures. That was last time, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
We had a halfling come in by the name of Antis. And he kind of did some time warpy magic and set up the whole place to explode itself. So we all managed to survive and escape. The halfling, or the changeling that was just kind of captured there, went by the name Ott. Kind of just seemed like someone that was just brought in into the religion, kind of drank too much of the Kool-Aid. And then, as Kuven was saying, we kind of made it back to the Adventurers Guild. We got a new job where we've got to save some fishermen and boats.
Yes, thank you. And just to clarify, Anton, who you saw, was not a halfling. He was a dwarf. Slightly taller. Still shorter than you. Maybe Rathrin. Maybe that's a gray area. The difference between a dwarf and a halfling and a gnome. Who knows? If they're shorter than you, yeah. All right, cool. Thank you. Thank you. Killian, you're next.
We picked up our mission from the Clifftop Adventurers Guild and we were debating how to get to our location. I believe we decided to go with the default. Lightning rail to Star Alaska, down to Sterngate, and then through the Margul Pass. And we're working our way to Rhukaan. Is that correct?
Yeah, the Rhukaan Draal is the capital city of Darguun. Yes.
Mm-hmm. And yeah, because we are looking into pirates that have been capturing fishermen and edging into people's territory in the Kraken Bay in that little inlet near Reklor.
Yeah, thank you. Next, Alistia. Any more details you want to add?
Yeah, I guess we're supposed to meet up with, I can't remember, Bog something. I can't remember the creature, but he's supposed to take us down the river. He's our
puddle
first
glum.
A puddle glum, that's right. And he's supposed to take us down the river, and then we are to talk with the Fisherman's Guild, and then there's like a goblin warlord that we're supposed to talk to in the city as well. His name means something like money, but I can't remember what it is. But
Curran Boss.
Curran Boss.
Curran is right. The goblin word for money.
Yeah, money boss. That's right. Get in touch with him just to, you know, check in. But yes, as Audrey said, we're supposed to rescue some fishermen that pirates are taking and maybe like figure out why.
Yeah, sweet. And then TDK?
Words are hard. So yeah, the only thing that I don't have, or that I have that you guys haven't said, but the fortress was Hawk Pelagi. Is that the place that we?
Yeah.
Yeah. Current boss, which is the money boss, he's got a job, and he's offering 1,000 platinum. So those of us that are greedy, and yeah, we're gonna go find Tormen, and we'll find Puddlegum, and you guys, we all got it. We're heading there right now.
Yeah. So you have boarded a lightning rail, and you are currently on your first day's trip out of the city of Sharn, and you've been introduced to your new to a new member of your group. They're from the Clifftop Adventurers Guild. Not as high rank as you, but seem to be at least capable of handling themselves. Kai, welcome to the group, by the way. Would you like to just describe for the masses your character? What do they look like? Yeah.
Yeah, Bavgai is a human, sort of an olive-colored skin tone. He is very bald, shiny head. He doesn't wear any sort of clothes on the top half of his body at any time. He carries around a quarterstaff. He's got a big old beaded necklace and some monkey robe-like trousers that he wears. He keeps the Clifftop badge on his belt. He doesn't travel with much. He pretty much just has a single satchel that he has.
I picture it as a belt buckle. Does he wear the Clifftop Adventurers Guild like right in the middle, like a big obnoxious cowboy belt buckle?
Not right in the middle, okay. Because he had an incident where he got hit in the stomach and the badge sort of compressed down and nailed him right in the delicate bits. So he keeps it off to the off center now. He's learned from his mistakes.
Okay. All right. Cool. Thank you. So you are all, let's say you're on the leisure car of this lightning rail, and there are many other patrons, mostly upper class, because the lightning rail is not cheap. You're in the leisure car where it's kind of a public space, but there is a bar and kind of like the equivalent of instant kind of food. There's a nimble right who is currently working behind the bar and is serving drinks. You see wealthy nobles. There's a couple of halflings that you've seen coming and going that seem to be on a tour of some sort, talking about the different places they're going to go and see. And you've congregated as a group, because it is your job, Iron Seekers, to give this new member, Bavgai, the brief. They have come in here not really knowing what to expect. So it's time here for you all to converse. Talk about your mission.
Question, Zim. Are Kayla and Zaida in the car?
Yes,
with us,
they are. Okay. Lightning. Yes, because there are large creatures that actively participate in society, a lot of facilities and transportation methods had to be accommodated for, they have to be built for large creatures. Huge, maybe not as much. You might have to rent a car if you're bringing a huge friend along. But yes, Zaida, though slightly uncomfortably, is able to maneuver through the car. They don't take any more space than a centaur might. So, okay. Yeah, they are with you. Yeah.
Okay. So we also have a couple of fey companions with us, a horse and a dog. And is Deimos with us too, Kuben?
Yeah.
What does Deimos look like, if you don't mind? Like,
So Deimos is roughly dog shaped, but like more kind of out of a nightmare. It's like black steel. He's got like this kind of green glowing runes and things a part of him. Kind of this weird tail. So built fully like out of plates, meant more to protect and intimidate and kind of interpose himself between me and other hostiles.
So yeah, have at it, guys. I'm not unless you would like me to roll initiative for the conversation, which I can do. Have at it. Get to know each other.
I can understand it's a bit jarring to just go, I remember when I was your rank. It was like it was yesterday.
It was yesterday.
You have a lot of strange friends that you bring with you.
Yeah, there's a bit of a motley crew we've got going. And there's also, I have Coronis on my shoulder, my crow or raven familiar as well.
Right.
yeah. We like to make sure we have all bases covered.
Well,
so what do you know about the mission? What have they told you? Or are we supposed to do the full briefing?
I was told you guys would do the full briefing. I haven't worked for a clifftop for very long. Made my way down here not too long ago. I say down here to Sharn not too long ago from the Talenta Plains. So I don't have much in the way of details.
Alrighty, people are snatching up fishermen, edging in on some goblin warlord on his business. And we're being sent out to find out. That's the very rough of it. Anyone else want to chip in?
And we're getting fish.
TDK laughs at his lizard friend who is always hungry.
Yeah, well, this is a very well-paying gig. How long have you been involved with the Adventurers Guild? Clifftop Guild, sorry. No, we're Adventurers. That one.
Only a handful of months. I didn't have much knowledge of the ways. I'm pretty good at what I do, apparently.
Well, that's good. It's nice to have somebody with authority in what they do in this group. Because apparently,
authority is a loose word.
The god above has deemed we need help.
Yeah, no, we'll find out more when we get down there, but the big thing is people are scrunched up enough coin to hire us because people are being kidnapped and forced into labor that they didn't sign up for. Some of it seems to be just trading one boss for another, but we don't know who that is.
And is this attached to the fishermen?
Yeah, they're grabbing up fishermen, their ships, what have you, and just kind of edging in on the territory from what we know.
It's always problematic to defend or work for a warlord, I think.
Yes, but also the treaty is very important to me and the way of life where I come from. So I'll do everything in my power, regardless of who I have to work for.
We have a medical bot, right?
Oh, yeah, we you just do, keep adding and it on is, to this.
It is right next to Kuven, wherever Kuven goes. It seems is to think
basically
Kuven is Papa, yeah.
Yeah, Kuven's surrounded by mechanicals, apparently. He's got his steel defender. He's got the medical bot. I also thought of taking like the other infusion where he gains like a homunculus or something. Too.
Go, my children.
Just be a petting zoo. Yeah.
A mechanical.
At this point,
petting zoo. Yeah.
At this point, are we even allowed to be stealthy?
Yeah, Kuben's a bit of a conundrum, I guess, at times. So.
At this conversation, as you guys are sort of discussing it and openly talking about the CAG, you've probably got your badges showing. I mean, you're like the sapphire is so shiny. It's brand new, guys. And the Nimble Right, as it's, you know, kind of serving drinks, you know that it definitely understands. It doesn't really speak very much, except for the cliche bartender replies, like, takes all kinds, you know, or every once in a while it'll shift a drink and kind of like, boy, if I had a dime for every time I heard that, you know, typical like nonsense. But there is a halfling that's down at the end of this bar, and there's a huge window behind the bar. So as you're discussing it, every once in a while there's this flash of lightning, this that goes past, and a very fast moving landscape. You're currently passing by what's known as the King's Forest. So off to the east, you see just an expanse of beautiful wilderness, old growth trees. It's been called, you know, like the pride of Breland, this forest, which is why it's called the King's Forest. But in that backdrop, this halfling, who seems to be nursing some sort of cocktail, she says, "Well, I heard that the CAG is on their way out. Supposedly, the Death's Gate is taken on your territory, from what I've heard." Takes a little sip.
Is that who we had that brawl with? Like, down in the...
Did we send a bunch of them packing and running in fear one time? I don't remember.
Yeah, they left one of their new recruits. Not much loyalty in that bond.
Oh, is that so? Well, I wouldn't know. I just know what I read in the papers. Takes another little sip.
Well, I read in the papers, and then he'll slip into halfling and say, "Halflings without mounts aren't threats to anyone."
She smiles and she says, "Yeah, you smell like the plains. I'm not from Talenta, but thanks anyway." She takes a sip. "Dinosaur riding is for mutants and barbarians, as far as I'm concerned.
And those who don't want to die in trains."
I like this new guy.
She crosses her legs, you know, and she gives you a little bit of a wink, and she was like, "It's all just conversation. Don't need to get your muscles all tense." Takes another little sip, and she says, "I'm just curious about, you know, what's going on. I hear you talking about different places, and did I hear you mention you're going close to the Mornland?"
In a ways. All right, is this still in halfling?
No, she's talking to Common. She was okay. Only retorting sassy stuff, I think, in halfling back to, "I'm going to get your name memorized one of these days. Bav guy."
Maybe. We don't know where the wind will blow us.
I suppose things in Sharn were getting a little funny. I did read in the papers again. Reading papers, and she winks at Bob Guy. Something about New Warforged or something? I just was reading about it. Do you know anything about it? Having one with your group?
No, didn't find anything about any new Warforged. Nothing that I've heard of.
Warforged are not allowed to be created anymore.
Well, that's what they say, isn't it? But we all know. Warmongers. Are they ever not working?
Well, the business of war is plentiful and good, apparently.
I'd expect to hear something like that from one of you. And she says, looking at TDK the Warforged. Anyways, nice to meet all of you. I'd like for all of you to make a perception check, please.
Ooh.
28.
It starts.
Wow, 28.
Oh, wow. You like those wisdom-based characters. Yeah, for sure. All right, well, Killian had no idea that one of the other, that one of, and Kuven, I think maybe was offended by the reference of maybe a sideways stab at House Caneth being a warmonger. Rathrin, maybe smelling some of the food from the kitchen. I don't know. Your attention was elsewhere, but Alistia.
I'm chewing on bones.
But Alistia, TDK, and Bavgai, you all pick up on a second halfling that was attempting to pickpocket Killian. While the conversation was going on, just happened to walk past, accidentally bump in, but you couldn't help but notice it was an attempt to lift something off of Killian. What do you want to do?
Alistia will very casually draw her scimitar and put it to the halfling's throat.
Is there a casual way to draw one's scimitar? I'm just...
Yes.
Okay, yes, you're like...
Because she's very, you know.
Okay, sure. So what
she's
do you
like
do?
Casual death, you know.
What do you do with this scimitar when you draw it?
I put it up against the halfling's throat.
Ooh, just as a threat. Yeah, make an intimidation check. How about the others, the two of you who also discovered and saw this happen? What would you do?
Ooh.
Ooh.
Funny.
Nat.
I'll be near. Not doing anything yet. I want to see this guy's reaction.
All right. Who else picked up on it? It was TDK. What would TDK do in this situation?
I'm just gonna observe. I'm not gonna make any sudden moves. I see that it's been seen and handled.
Yeah. Well, I don't know if it's been handled, but it's definitely been threatened for sure. Okay. Yeah, as you put your throat up, they hold their hands up, and in their hand is... What do you keep your money in, Killian? Normally, what do you keep your money in?
Just a pouch. Nothing fancy.
The pouch is in their right hand.
It's called a purse.
And they're halfling. You know, they're not very tall. I would say with that incredible perception roll, Bavgai as well, you pick up just ever so slightly the faintest eye contact between the female who was conversing with you and the male. Just a real quick look of, oh shit. Before the halfling just says, I think you dropped this, sir, and hands it back to Killian. Pushes the blade very carefully away from their throat.
Alistair will say, I would encourage you not to happen upon others' money pouches on this train.
Understood. No harm intended. Of course. Excuse me. And they kind of like very quickly worm their way through the rest of the patrons on the leisure car and move farther back toward what you know is a seating room, which is just a series of seats in rows that's for people just mostly being quiet or reading or looking out the windows, quiet conversation. It's a more quiet car, the one just behind you.
You say a mount is for mutants and barbarians, but even you ride on the success of others. He'll say to the other halfling.
She finishes her drink and like slams it down and gets up with a huff and just walks out. Unless there's something else any of you wanted to try to say to her.
Can are there windows? Like, can you see from one car to the next?
You can vaguely see from one car to the next. There's a very small window. There's on the lightning rail, there are basically the car is all contained. The little transition between cars, there is a small port window that you can see, but it's difficult to see, but you can. The biggest windows are on the sides for, you know, seeing the landscape as it goes past.
Seeing that they go through, they went to the next car, correct?
Yes, they did.
I'm going to just sort of go over to the, I'd like to be able to see if I could see through the windows to see if I can still catch a hold of them where sure. They go, like just kind of nonchalantly looking back and forth.
Yeah.
I'm not going to go to the next car, but I want to see if I can see.
Yeah, they kind of close, and you can see that there are Magerites who work here on the lightning rail, employees of House Orien. As they go through and head back, they sit next to another halfling, and sitting across from them, some of the seats are facing like a group of four, you can see yet another halfling. And a moment afterwards, the female who finished her drink walks through, and the four of them seem to be sitting as a group.
Do I recognize any of these halflings? Do I see any marks or insignia?
I don't know if you would or not. Make a history check. Yes, there is one individual that you did see in the newspaper, actually. There was evidently a fight that happened near the lightning rail station in Sharn a while ago, and somebody interviewed briefly a halfling known as Corin Del Marco. Here's the name. I'll put it in the chat for you. Boo bam. Corin Del Marco. And once you put the face and you remember, where did I see this guy? Oh yeah, I saw him in the newspaper. He's a male Lightfoot halfling who was rumored, and the interviewer was asking if it was true that they had worked for the Barrowmoor clan. But they had denied the rumor. Anything the rest of you would like to do? You can carry on your conversation about the mission, or just continue on this trip.
So I'm going to go back to the group, assuming they haven't come over, and I explain that I think I've seen this guy, and I remember this interview. You guys want to go mix it up with him?
What'd you read about them in the interview?
they interviewed this guy, this fight at this train station, who, and they asked him if he was part of, what did you say, Zim? House?
The Barrowmoor clan.
The Barrowmoor clan.
Yeah, Barrowmoor clan.
Barrowmoor clan. But he claimed to not be.
Now, there's so many clans. Is this in our handouts? I've got the Kornberg Chronicle, the Voice of Thrain, Voice of Breland.
It wasn't a headline, and this is just something in passive reading. Yeah, that you remembered.
This is the halfling, like, crime family or whatever, right?
Yes.
Barrowmoor clan?
Yes.
Okay. So this may not be anything more than just some looters.
I think it's more opportunistic than anything.
I got the history check from TDK. Does anyone else here have a proficiency in history that they would like to exploit with a roll?
God damn it. That you could roll one worse, Killian.
Oh no!
Oh no!
Damn it, dude! Alright, just get him out of the way now before anything dire like life saving is required of you. Alright. Alright, Kuven. Yeah. When Killian says, isn't that the crime syndicate? I don't know, dwarves or something? Like, he gets it totally wrong. But you are like, yes, based out of Sharn. There is a crime syndicate known as the Barrowmoor clan. I'd say with that role, yeah, you do pretty well here. They have been historically the most powerful criminal organization in Sharn. Originally a family of immigrants from the Talenta Plains, the Barrowmoor clan has built up a network of extortion, blackmail, corruption, smuggling, and gambling halls that run from Lower Dura to the Skyway. They are low class, mid class, upper class. They are all over, and they have their fingers deep in the pockets of most of Sharn. The current Boromar Patriarch is someone known as Sidan Boromar, a member, supposedly, of the Gold Concord of the Aurum.
Oh, interesting.
Awesome. Have you been wearing those rings, Kuvin? The copper ones that I gave you?
I haven't, rings. I haven't been wearing them visibly, no.
Okay. Well, that tracks with what I've heard about the Aurum.
The Gold Concord of what?
Aurum.
The Aurum.
Aurum. So perhaps.
So perhaps we don't really need to take on for no real big reason other than just being pickpocketed. A big mob.
Yeah, that seems like an enemy we probably don't need to make.
At this point, we'll take him down eventually. When we're, you know, whatever, when we're gold level, sterling silver, when we're sterling silver, nickel silver.
Yeah, so I guess we just fill in any other details after that excitement about heading out to Kraken Bay. Yeah, and just enjoy the ride. It's the lap of luxury, so. And we're on it for a couple days, right? Because we're on it till Star Alaska, then we head south.
Exactly, yeah. You're still going to be in Breland. You're not actually entering any other countries while you're on the Lightning Rail. But Star Alaska is the farthest that the Lightning Rail can take you east before it heads. Takes you down south towards the border of Breland, Zilargo, and Darguun. You're kind of close to like where the three countries kind of have a meeting, where the Lightning Rail would continue south to Korenberg, but you actually need to go a little bit east from there towards the Mornland, where you're then going to hop on a caravan and then on a waterway, known as the Gaul River.
And once we cross over into Darguun, we just have to be careful to follow goblin law. But if we are attacked, we are allowed to defend ourselves. So yeah, it'll no longer be Brelish law.
What is goblin law? I didn't think goblins had a lot of laws. Except blowing stuff up. Goblin law.
Yeah, that was one of those things we probably should have looked up before leaving. Is there a check or anything?
Can make a history check on it.
Yeah, I would say this is kind of weird because it's not exactly history, maybe history. Sure, but I'll just take your history check from before, except for Killian. I'll let you roll again because that was pathetic. And anybody who did not roll, anybody who didn't roll before, just on the off chance you've come across some goblin society and might know a little bit more about it. Good thing I asked for those not proficient in history to roll. Yeah, I'd say Alistia and Rathrin, you're definitely aware that the goblin norm is to have some sort of order. It's not complete chaos. You would think a totally chaotic realm might be Droam, the monstrous country to the west, or even farther northwest in the Demon Wastes. You know, that's total chaos up there. But Darguun, they seceded from the land of Ciri before the Day of Mourning. They claimed independence. They organized. They got a military together. They formed political groups. They seem to be able to keep order. However, supposedly slavery has been outlawed, though it is a part of their past. So whether or not you will see slavery, you're not exactly sure. Supposedly it's been abolished, but that might just be lip service to try to keep, you know, probably humanitarians off their borders. But yeah, I'd say it's a fairly, there's definitely consequence if you're going to go around just murdering. I'd say that's about as much as you're going to get. In terms of specific bylaws and whatnot, it probably changes from town to town, city to city, or tribe to tribe. I can give you a little bit more information about Darguun, if you all like. Since I got a natural 20. The primary race at 39% of the population is goblins. They are the primary race. You'll see more goblins than anything else, followed closely by hobgoblins and bugbears. Humans only make up about a 6% population in Darguun. Kobolds, you'd see as many kobolds as you would see humans. They have been known to be large suppliers of mercenary groups because of hobgoblin potential to be a war type, a warrior like population. So there you go. Anything else you guys want to talk about while you're on your trip? All right, cool. After your lightning rail connects, you go through the capital city of Rote. You're able to stop. Is there any shopping anybody has not been able to accomplish that they want to? You are going through one of the biggest cities in Breland.
One thing I was looking for was a spell scroll. I'm not sure if I'd be able to find here.
You don't have a lot of time. So what I want you to try is roll a D100. We'll say if you're in the upper 50%, you're able to find one.
Of course not, it's me.
If you had more time, you could definitely find one in the metropolis. But the lightning rail schedule is kind of pushing you as a timeline. You're not able to get
Understandable.
One.
Understandable. Yep.
Anything else anybody might try to find on one of these stops along the way?
I think Coogan's going to look for a couple of bombs, because why not?
Okay. Do you have a keg of gunpowder?
I do.
Okay. You could fashion your own bombs. All you really need are little, like, ceramic jars, and you could basically portion out your own gunpowder.
I'll do.
If you wanted to. Yeah. But that's kind of your prerogative. Yeah. If you want to buy them, they are kind of pricey. That's all I'm saying.
Yeah, I'll buy the materials that I need and then just make them.
You can get 10 clay pots for a gold piece. And each clay pot can essentially be used to make a grenade of sorts, a bomb.
How much of my keg of gunpowder would that use up?
I think you've got a handout for firearms for, I think, the amount of gunpowder required. And because you are a patron and a strong supporter of D&D Beyond, if you don't find it in our handout, I know that there's information on D&D Beyond that can help you with the amount of powder required for a fragment grenade type of thing. All right, anything else?
If I wanted to try to make some potions of healing, do I need to buy material for that for my herbalism kit?
Yes, and it's half the cost. Okay. So instead of 50 gold for a potion of healing, you'd only need to spend 25. And if you have the kit, won't even make you roll for it. You're just able to make it. It just takes you time.
Okay. I might just be doing that, so I could probably do that on my own math.
Yeah, at the bar. Why not? You know, like the Nimble Wright's mixing drinks, you're mixing healing potions. No problem. Anything else? Now that you guys know a little bit more about where you're going, what you're up against, any other supplies you might want to acquire? Okay, then. when the lightning rail brings you to the small city known as Sterngate, there's a caravan that is waiting for you. And that caravan is going to be populated by members of House Orien. And there's a little bit of flexing going on with the House Orien guards, and the fact that that you're going to be riding along. They first accuse you of just having lots of money and buying your weaponry and your fancy animals and your shiny armor and your little automatons and your basic entourage, and that you need their protection. Other than
just
that,
give them kind of like quirked eyebrow and roll the eyes.
Okay, yeah. Other than that, there's not much that happens on this caravan until you reach the second day. On the second day of travel, there is a fortune teller who is riding along with the group. She has her own carriage, horse drawn, and she is offering to tell fortunes and to, for a small price, read your fortunes. Is anyone interested?
Can I roll an insight check to see if she seems authentic or just like a huckster kind of thing?
Sure.
I still haven't rolled above a 10, I think, for that since training for my proficiency.
How much is she charging?
Well, for you, my dear, if you would like for me to simply look at your palms and predict your future, 1 gold. However, if you are interested in drawing a card from my special deck, now that's a little bit more. But I'm available for the conversation.
I assume Rathen will give a piece of gold, assuming fortune means like food or something. Not fully understanding.
All right. So you pay the gold. I'd like you to roll a D100, please. Oh, my dear. I see carnage in your future. Dead all around you, slain. And you, I see as being very well fed.
That's just a normal day.
She says, beware, and I'd say even Killian with his horrible insight can see a little bit of drama at this point. Beware, I see you in the need of additional divining support. Perhaps you would like to reconsider taking a deck, a card from my deck.
Rathen just sniffs at it and just walks away.
Anyone else want to take advantage of the fortune teller?
Killian will. He sees she's hamming it up with the fortunes, but wants to see what's up with the deck. So he'll go up and how much for a pull from the deck?
For you, well, normally I charge 25 gold to draw.
Okay. Hands over the 25 gold.
As she takes out the deck and you take a look, and she begins to shuffle it a little bit, and then she sets it down. She says, now don't pick a card just yet. She fans them out before you on this rickety kind of table that's in the back of her carriage as it's kind of like going over bumps here and there. And it's like, for you just kind of sitting there, it almost feels you're off balance every couple of moments. Well, she fans these out in front of you. And she says, now just graze your hand across the cards. And you're feeling for a coolness, or maybe heat, or maybe a tingle. Let the cards speak to you, and they will reach out to you which of them wants to be drawn.
He will do as she says and reach out for feeling any tingle, heat, cool sensation.
Okay, I need you to roll a d13.
5.
Okay, as you reach across and you find a card, and how does it trigger you? In other words, like what does it feel like, or what happens to Killian that makes him pick this card?
Feels warm. Like like holding someone's hand kind of thing, that initial warmth.
Okay. So the card that you pick as you flip it over, you see first thing that is evident is that it's a female as you flip the card over. And then as you look a little closer and you try to see exactly what you're looking at here, there's actually, instead of a single female, it's actually three females that are sort of superimposed upon each other. And the fortune teller, you pull the card and she says, would you like for me to look at it, or would you like to try to decipher it yourself?
Let me try deciphering it first. If I need help, I'll ask for it.
All right, I'm going to give you another chance to roll an insight check here.
A 6.
I mean, the fact that you can tell that there are three females and not one, that's about as good as it gets, you know? When you look at it, it's kind of strange, you know? Like, there's other iconography. One of them seems to be holding a pair of scissors. You're not really sure what it is. Do any of the rest of you he's in the carriage. Would any of the rest of you have joined Killian and maybe give him a hand with this insight? Anybody else can roll if their curiosity is piqued and they'd like to peek in as Killian is having his fortune told. Alistia. Yeah, and Kuvin. I'll say Alistia's head like pops in, Kuvin's head pops in, and they look at each other and they're like, yeah. The tarot card is technically called the Three of Cups. And the iconography that is seen here are the Fates.
Yeah, I was gonna say it's the Fates.
As you look at this card, she takes in a deep breath. Keep this card with you. I believe it will help you in the future. If something happens and you don't like it, maybe this card will help you avoid that situation. I can't promise that it will happen more than once.
Alrighty, he looks a little dubious, but he'll stick it into like an inner coat pocket.
Okay. All right, very cool. So it enables you, technically speaking, do you know this card?
Mm-hmm.
All right, so yeah, you can add to the, there you go. It's a fairly powerful testing of fate.
He'll just sit in thought, go back to their carriage, thinking about it.
All right. Anyone else interested in testing fate and their dice?
Deck of anything? Oh yeah.
Is that a yes or no? Are we good?
Sure, I'll try.
This all is right. My favorite item in all of D&D. I love.
So as Alistia looks and sees, oh, he got something nice, you know, and he walks away with it.
I'm not going to get something so nice, but.
She says, oh, hello, my dear. How are you?
I am good. How are you?
I'm wonderful. Am I reading your palms today, or are you also interested in drawing a card?
I will draw a card. How many gold is it?
25 gold. Okay. Thank you. And please, and as she fans them out, she gives you the same spiel. Mm-hmm. Reach across the top. You're waiting for a feeling. Let the card speak to you.
Okay.
All right, let's roll a d13.
Okay. Oh, goodness.
A 13. Okay. So the card that you pull, why did you pick this one? How did it appeal to you?
I felt a little zap, like electricity.
A little zap. Okay. All right. As you pick up the card, the zap like continues. It's almost like electric as it hits you. And the picture you look at is the image of a man that has been hanged.
Oh, God.
Roll an insight check. And okay. Anybody else who's there, you're welcome to roll insight as well.
Oh, Killian, you touched my dice.
Kuven, because you were like, you peeked in on Killian, and you were kind of like, I want to make sure he doesn't get in any trouble, right? And then Alistia's up there like, oh, shit, I got to babysit everybody. Yeah, you know that, or you've read about the hanged man is known as the Joker or the Jester. And what this does is, as you're holding it, the image sort of changes. And you hear an audible sound as though coin is falling into a bag, but in large amounts, like shh, shh, shh. It's like absolutely amazing. The sound is making you feel greedy, even if you're not a greedy person. And she hears the sound and she says, this card will instantly disappear in your hands for 10,000 gold if you wish it. Or you can give it back to me and I'll give you 2 more cards to draw from my deck.
I have 10,000 gold.
You want the gold?
Oh, I see. I can get 10,000 gold or I can draw two more cards. Mm-hmm.
Ubin's riveted at this point. That's a lot of gunpowder I could buy with that.
Yeah, suddenly TDK's interested.
gosh. Is a lot of gold.
Come on, Bezos.
What to do? So, like, how like powerful is the urge to be greedy?
You have to search your own personality traits, flaws, and bonds for that one. I can't answer that for you. No one can answer that for you, Alistia.
Alistia's really not into money. she'll draw two more cards.
Wow.
Yes, oh. I love it. I love the deck of it.
It was getting everybody's attention.
Wow, guys. Oh my goodness, I'm so excited because all right, okay, that's great. I love this. So you give her the card back and she takes the card out of the deck. You notice she does not put it back. She instead tucks it into her own bag. And you can hear the clinging and the clanging of coin as she seems to have cashed in on that decision you've made. Okay. So now there are only 12 cards to pull from the deck, so I need you to roll a d12. Twice.
Okay.
Two times.
Okay. And then another time?
So when you draw the first card, would you look at it or would you go ahead and draw the second right away?
I'll draw them, like, I'll draw both before looking.
Okay, all right, excellent. All right. You're feeling lucky, kid, I think, is what that translates as. All right. The first card that you see, I'm not going to make the insight check anymore. As you pull the card, I'll say, Kuven, I don't know. Did you memorize this? Did you read about it in a book? How do you know so much, Kuven?
Yeah, I'm sure in his studies, he's come across this between this history and arcana knowledge. I'm sure he's pretty aware.
All right. The first card is the Jack of Spades, a rogue. And as you pull this card, she looks at it and she says, oh dear, I'm so sorry. But it seems that one of your friends has turned against you.
I mean, that's a lot of gold.
He's like,
I can't tell you much more than that, my dear, other than it is a deep hatred now, magical in nature. It will be secret until the time is ripe for it to be revealed with a devastating effect. Now, for your other card, she gets suddenly cheerful. You have drawn the King of Spades, otherwise known as the Tower or Ruin. Ooh. Alistia, the card evaporates. It just disappears in your hand.
Not good.
And as it does also, your wealth and property begin to, one by one, disappear. All non-magical possessions begin to vanish.
All right, well, that's everything.
As you sit there and she puts her cards back and begins to fold them into the leather pouch, she seems ready for the next individual. But you, Alistia, as you begin to stand up and walk out or maybe hop out of her moving carriage, your wealth is gone. Your non-magical weapon, your two-bladed scimitar, vanishes. Mm-hmm. The very clothes you wear begin to disappear. Alistia, quickly, you run to, where do you go? What do you do?
I guess I go to the carriage and
back with the fortune teller?
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm like,
Kuven will help since he's
How do you help Kuven? She's losing
I guess
quite literally everything.
Well, first he'll take off his cloak, you know, and just like here, like and I guess since he's kind of seen and witnessed this deck and from his history, he knows like obviously really bad things can happen, but really good things can happen too. So I think he'll take a turn at the deck in hopes that maybe he can get something to help her get her stuff back.
So as you are helping her, who she has lost everything, you decide, well, I'll have a go.
And here's all my stuff.
You give her
all my stuff.
Hold my everything.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Are you paying the 25 gold, my dear?
Can I get more draws if I pay more money?
You can.
Interesting. So, at least, hang on, I need to get some money out of my stuff. So, is the rest of the party there? Like, I'm going to consult, like, how many should I take, guys? Like, what do you think? At least two, maybe.
Catherine is not the one to ask.
Catherine's like, is there anything I can eat in the deck? I eat the deck. And then...
Two might be a bit much, or anything more than two might be a bit much.
Okay. I'll ask her the price for two.
Two cards? I'm so in... I'm inspired at your bravery, but yes, 40 gold for two.
All right. Well, there's a group discount.
Next, I'm going to make the medical bot pull a couple. So. Let's
see. All right, so you're going to draw from this deck of many things, huh? All right, Kuven,
yeah.
D12s.
I just don't want to pull the death card.
Watching from the door.
What am I rolling?
Two D12s. You're drawing two cards, right?
Right.
Yeah,
you want me to roll them individually?
Two D12s,
right?
Man.
One and then another. One. Oh, that's good. And a seven.
A one and a seven. Okay. The first... Do you look at the first card, or do you draw them both before?
Yeah, I'll draw them, like, both and lay them in front of him and then just like flip over one at a time.
Okay. The first card that you draw is the King of Diamonds. The Sun.
Ooh, that doesn't sound bad.
Mm-hmm. And she looks at the card and she says, oh, good fortune is yours. My goodness. What this translates as is that you get to gain a beneficial medium, a wondrous item, and 50,000 XP.
Suddenly I feel like I know a lot more.
The XP we're going to put toward the party because we're working in milestones here, but that's very cool for you. It doesn't specifically give me indications in terms of like a level advancement, but I will defer to you, Michael, on this one. How did you handle, or did you have to handle a 50,000 XP increase?
I did. That was the one that Raina drew, and how you guys went from level 3 to level 9.
Mm-hmm.
When you guys pulled the carding in the Curse of Strahd campaign.
Okay.
So I just had everyone... But we're currently level 6, so it says I went off the XP requirements from that.
Yeah. Well, what would that do for you guys? We're going to do this, guys. It's happening. Good fortune has fallen onto Kuvan, and unfortunately, terrible fortune fell upon Alistia. So what will 50,000? 50,000, yeah.
That'll get us to level 9.
Welcome to level 9, Iron Seekers.
Oh, my God.
Jeez.
Yeah, because it's 14,000 to get to level 6, and then it's 10. And then it's 64,000 to get to level 10, so that's exactly 50,000.
So is that level 9?
Level 10.
Level 10, ladies and gentlemen. We have hit the big time. And Kuvan, I would like for you to roll... let's roll for the wondrous item. It's telling me a medium. Not sure what that means. Roll for a medium wondrous item. It's kind of an old system.
You roll on random tables. Medium random tables.
Michael, how would you handle that?
A medium. Like I would say probably an uncommon or rare.
All right.
Uncommon or rare, yeah.
Let's roll a D100 to see if it's uncommon or rare. Above 50, it's a rare item. Under 50, it's uncommon. Kuvan, you drew the card. It's a rare item. All right, my man. So you can filter. Yeah, you can filter using D&D Beyond rare items and roll for it. We're gonna take a short break here after this next card because we have a little bit of work to do. So we're gonna do this off stream for a little bit. Otherwise, this can be quite dull as we progress big time. So the second card that you drew the seventh card, right? You drew a seven.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay.
I like the sound of that.
You draw the Eight of Swords, the King of Clubs, Kuvan, otherwise known as the Void. It's a black card, and as you draw it, right after the sun illuminates you and powers up your party, unfortunately, this black card spells instant disaster.
More instant than mine?
Kuvan.
Oh, even more instant than yours.
Kuvan, your body continues to function as though comatose. But your psyche is trapped like in a prison somewhere, in an object on a far plane or planet, possibly in the possession of some sort of extraplanar being.
Unfortunately, my card only undoes something that happened to me.
Well, at least Alistia has a lot of cool stuff now.
So, he's not... can't see him, correct? He's not on this plane?
No.
No, he's still here.
He's still here. Oh, his mind
but his soul was taken soul away.
He's trapped by something on another plane. A banishment spell would do that, basically?
Banishment takes the whole body. This is a separation of the material and
so
the
restoration
spiritual.
Or revivify or all that wouldn't work with that.
You know, Wish can't restore this.
Would I...
No. Wait, Wish can't?
Wish can reveal where it is.
Would I, in my experience, with specifically separating your astral self from your physical self, lend me any expertise in how to locate or retrieve something like this?
Yeah. What kind of a check would this be, I think? Let's put this in a skill category for you. Think of spell casting, like a wisdom sort of check? What do you think? I'll let you choose.
Insight, maybe?
Yeah.
Or insight, yeah.
Maybe insight. Yeah, I can do insight.
That's wisdom based too, so.
Bavgai, you're not exactly sure. But it might be possible to project oneself to go and visit wherever Kuvan's psyche is currently residing.
I'll relay that.
how many cards are left? Seven? Six?
Oh my god, you guys. I can't believe you.
I think 10 are left.
Well, technically, outside of the Joker, anything that's pulled goes right back in.
Back in.
But like, okay. I pulled a card, and you still rolled out of 13.
You can still
get some. I rolled out of 12.
I kept my card. No, oh, you rolled out of 12 once you did the Joker.
Oh, yeah. So 11, right?
The void might be back in. I've had multiple voids happen in a pool before.
Yeah, but she pulled the Joker and put it in her pouch.
Yeah, and that's
the
why
the Joker is not the void. It's a different card.
Well, yeah, how many cards started?
13. And I pulled my card, and I still have it, but there's still 13. There were still 13 cards in the deck when you rolled.
Right, and then she took the Joker.
Which took it down
so there's
to 12. 12.
Okay, there's 12.
So there's still 12 in the rotation.
Got it.
If you pulled two, there's 12. Is there a chance that one of us could pull a card that could bring him back?
There is. Oh.
Is there a card in there that's like you can fix something from another person?
I think there's a wish card.
Okay, wish would work for that.
Wish would help us know where he is. This is essentially a
wish would allow
card.
Us to cast astral projection as well, so someone could go get him potentially.
How would you bring him back?
In other words, you guys have another adventure down the line.
Well, wait a minute. Is Kuvin basically a zombie right now?
Comatose. Well, no, he's not a zombie. He's just comatose.
Okay.
We're
so
gonna
we gotta.
Take, all right. We're going to take a little 5 minute break. Because
so
even,
I start fastening a leash around my waist to
though,
him so he can just like get pulled along.
That would be so fun. We're gonna pause. We're gonna come back here because y'all tested fate and I had nothing to do with it. We'll be back in just a few minutes, guys. Thanks for hanging out. So, bringing us back here with the Iron Seekers, newly stripped of all belongings, empowered, given some potential, and then separated from their bodies, and put into a comatose-like state. Okay. Currently, Alistia, you are wearing Kuvin's cloak and holding all of his shit. As he just sits back and slumps in the chair, comatose. And the rest of you now, I don't know what you all are doing. Why don't you enlighten us? What the hell are you doing, Iron Seekers?
PDK, before you, I know you had mentioned wanting to risk it. I have the Fates card. I can pull, see if I find something, and if it's either bad or... if it's bad or not worth it, I can undo the decision to draw from the deck. Do I think that would work, Sim?
I mean, we're in new territory. Would you like to ask the fortune teller what she thinks? Or do you want to use a skill check for this? I'll give you some decision making here.
I'll ask her. So, is there anything in that dumb deck that can help us get our friend back that you're aware of?
Yes. There's definitely a card that you could draw that would help you join your friend, perhaps permanently. You could draw the same card.
No, not quite.
I've done a lot of traveling, young one. In fact, I've seen some that look like maybe your kin in the past. Anything is possible, I suppose. I'm surprised every time someone pulls from this deck.
Well, thank God Kuvin didn't draw the talents. That would have really sucked.
Which one?
Of the talents, every magic item you carry or wear it is disintegrated.
I'm sad about that.
Good thing that, like, I didn't have the same weapon that I had in my other game, which was, like, my ancestral weapon, because I would have lost my shit.
So do we want to risk it, or... figure out how to help him on our own.
I think I would vote to risk it, because trying to go and find him, that means what do we do with the clifftop adventurers? Put that aside and do this first? Are we going to be strong enough to get there? How do we even get there? Or, I don't know. I don't know.
If anyone else wants to try and risk it, they're welcome to, but I have what I hope is a get-out-of-jail-free card.
Bob guy.
I'm willing to put the risk.
What are you sort of like, when you say, you know, your experience or your training revolving or having to do with the astral plane or projection, what specifically is going through Bob Guy's mind?
I'm thinking of how, as a way of the astral self monk, I am able to separate my astral self and use it in combat.
Is this something you're capable of doing now?
Projecting things. Only partially. Nothing as strong as, and even the greatest way of the astral self monks cannot enter the astral plane with their astral selves. It's mostly a momentary separation to aid in combat and physical feats.
But you definitely touch upon it, and maybe you could serve as a guide. If someone was attempting this, like if they were going to use a scroll of some sort to cast a spell beyond their own capacity. Okay, all right.
And so you guys know if it can't be done, I'm okay. It's the risk of playing the game too, right? So.
No, we're going to come save you.
No, this is great, man. I love this. I love this.
Well, like I said, I take a rope and tie myself to Kuban.
No, we can put him on the horse.
Yeah. Oh. You just tie him onto the horse.
As you say that, and you go to your mount, your companion, your Valinar steed, they nip at you.
Ew.
Alistia.
Yeah.
You take 4 points of damage.
They hate you.
Oh, God.
As
she's naked?
As Zaida.
The card she drew.
Seems to have had a change of heart towards you. Aww. She seems under some sort of powerful enchantment and looks upon you as her mortal enemy.
All possessions.
Why couldn't it have been Coven when he came back?
This is not a possession of yours. This was a friend.
This is the rogue card. Yeah.
Yeah. Can someone else come talk to her? Okay.
I can try.
So this is an enchantment. Zim, so at some point we might be able to break it.
Nothing less than the wish spell or divine intervention can end it.
All right. Who's divine? Well, someone pray for me.
Kuban, your next character needs to be a cleric and they need to come in. Level 10, they'll have divine intervention.
A rich cleric who can replace all of her belongings. Yeah.
We can purchase these spells potentially at a place, right?
At a metropolis? Yeah, absolutely. You're going to have to
learn how to fortune teller and take the 10,000 gold. I'm an asshole.
Killian walks back to the fortune teller, holds up 3 fingers.
Oh. Not read between the lines?
No. No. How much for 3?
Oh, Jesus.
She looks at you almost, you know, like, with sympathy at this point, and she says, I have seen more than my fair share of those that push fate beyond reason, almost as though it becomes an obsession. I want you to think about this. I I will be leaving soon. And no longer available.
I have the cards on my side.
10,000 gold. This.
How many cards do you wish to draw?
I would like to draw 3.
60 gold.
Done. All right, so 3d12.
Okay, yeah. Let's do this, man. Draw your first card. There are 12 cuz you know one is gone.
Would Greater Restoration take care of the anger? No. It's got to be wish or
wish your divine intervention. Zim has changed something. But...
No, it's as the card reads, a wish or divine intervention is required.
Right, so I'm going to pull all of them and then look at them.
Okay. All right.
Is divine intervention an actual spell? Or is that just you pray
it's
for
the,
it?
It's the cleric ability. You roll a d100, and if you roll lower than your level, you can ask your god to come down and fix something for you.
What's your first card there, Killian?
Oh, okay. So I'm doing them in order. So 4 is the first one.
All right. The first card that you draw is the King of Hearts.
Aww.
The throne. 4 wands depicted upon this. So from how I read this, it says you now become a true leader in people's eyes. You gain a castle that appears in any open area that you wish, but it must be made within 1 hour's time.
Oh shit, just looks at the side of the road just as we're flying by.
So I'm gonna say on a diplomacy check, so those are gonna be charisma based checks.
Mm-hmm.
Is it a permanent bonus? It says +6 bonus to your diplomacy checks.
Okay.
Doesn't say that it's temporary. It just says that the decision where to place your small castle has to be made within 1 hour.
Okay, so I'm looking at a map. We are traveling between Starl Oscar and Sterngate.
Yeah,
right
let
now.
Me let me let me let me let you pull out your map of Corbear. Oh my god. Oh my god, we're off the rails, guys. I love it. Yeah, so you're out. I can't actually see the map yet, it's still super fuzzy for me.
Alrighty.
Yeah, you have passed the Seawall Mountains, and you are now, nearing the Gathering Stone. So that's here on the map. Can you all see this?
Wait, I thought we were still on the... Oh, no, okay, we're on the thing.
You're
on
the caravan.
Great, I get a castle and fucking Darguun. Awesome.
Get a goblin castle, that's cool.
Can I see the Gaul River from where we are?
No, because like... it doesn't look like that far, but that's 30 miles to the south of you. You can't see that far on the horizon. You're traveling through wilderness.
The wilderness look like? Is it just plains? Is it forested? Is it...
This is like highlands. So you've got mix. You'll have bits of forest here and there, rock outcropping, small mountains here and there, but you've passed a major mountain range. So every once in a while, you'll see a little bit of a plateau, but it's mixed highlands.
Okay, right there, and it's on one of the plateaus kind of thing, overlooking part of the...
North or valley. South of this King's Road area?
South.
So toward the river?
Towards the river, yes.
Oh my god. Okay. So as you just look and you just say, there, that looks like a good spot. Yeah, fucking nothing out there, and so you've got prime real estate. Please describe to us what this small castle looks like as it appears, because it is essentially in your mind as you see it. I'd say roll 2d10.
16.
16 rooms. Bedrooms. A grand feasting hall, full kitchen, small dungeon, and 4 towers.
The 4 towers are going to be at the corners of the outer walls. And then there's you know, the keep on the inside, you can't really see, but you just see a large tower kind of coming out. Just each of those is, each floor is a room. I'm a wizard, gotta keep the aesthetic going.
Oh my god.
So I'm just stacking the rooms on top.
Okay, yes. It's beautiful. And let's see. I've even got a stronghold little token for you here. There we go.
I just become a goblin warlord.
And you're on your way, man. You are on your way. Do we have a name for this castle now? Or you want to think about it?
I'll think about it. I think I have something for it.
Okay. All right. I'll save that for now. But yes, you now have an unoccupied castle. It's empty, unfurnished, but a small castle. Just appears. Are you thinking of detouring from this caravan over in that direction, or are you sticking with the caravan?
I'm sticking with the caravan.
Okay.
I think a castle made of black stone on the plains might be easy to...
Black stone. Oh my god. All right, sweet. Okay, oh my god. All right, so that happens. We're going to say you get a +6 on your... it says diplomacy, so I'm going to take that as intimidation, persuasion, or deception.
Okay.
You get a +6 on checks. Okay?
Alrighty.
What was that next number you drew?
10.
10? Yeah. Okay. So 10, is that the, let's see, 12, 11, 10. That's the King of Spades. That's ruin that you draw.
Alrighty.
That's the tower. And as you turn this card and you look at it, wealth and property. What?
Yeah, so the castle appears and fades away.
Wait, no, isn't that magical?
No, technically it's, yeah, property, so there's one more card.
Oh no.
Seven.
Oh no. Killian though, but all of your items begin to disappear.
Except for my magic items.
Yeah, but
he just stands there. He doesn't try and cover himself.
You're okay, so as your money disappears, as your non-magical items, this is all of your mm-hmm. possessions, your clothing. You just stand there in your naked glory. As your castle.
Yep, what's the next one?
Fades away. I'm going to delete it off the map here. As soon as it appeared, it's gone. Oh, I'm so sorry. Oh my god, you guys. I can't believe.
You don't need to go.
Alright, we're gonna have a Gambler's Anonymous session after this, guys. We really are. Okay, third card. What is it?
Was a 7.
7.
That was...
Okay. Oh, that was, what was the last one? Was it 10?
Yes.
9, 8, 7. Am I reading that wrong? 1, 2, 3. Oh, yeah. 4, 5, 6, 7. The Queen of Clubs, right? Flames. The picture on the tarot card is of the devil. Enmity between you and an outsider. Hot anger, jealousy, and envy are but a few of the possible motivational forces for this enmity. The enmity of this outsider can't be ended until one of the parties has been slain.
Making friends fast tonight.
Roll a d20. Because this is how long we have until this needs to be resolved. All right, so quite a few days, but there is something or someone who has now been... bound in direct opposition to you, Killian. You just get this weird, ominous feeling as though, oh great.
Now someone wants me dead. You know, I just think this was all just not worth it. I don't want to draw from the deck. And I'm going to use the Bates card to reverse my decision to draw the three cards.
Really? You're going to do that? You're going to move it back? You're not going to look at that fourth card? You're not looking at that.
I only pulled three.
Oh, you did only pull three.
Yeah, I only pulled three.
So you turn that Fates card. Your material belongings come back. The property is...
So essentially back. Yeah, still gone.
Castle never appeared. Was never even there. Oh my god. Was it just a mirage on the horizon?
Heat mirage.
Gosh, you guys.
What you saw of Killian was not a mirage, though.
That was real. Okay, guys.
So,
Hey, Kai, did you say something about planar binding as a spell?
It's astral projection.
Oh, okay. Would I be able to use planar binding to go find Kuven and try to bring him back and bind him to me?
That's a very interesting question. Is this a spell as a paladin that you will have access to?
Yes. Fifth level, which I'll have a spell.
Okay. You attempt to bind
Celestial
something
or elemental
to your service.
Or fiend. Oh, yeah.
Unfortunately, it does not allow you to connect to a humanoid, which is what you need. Right?
Mm-hmm.
But it could potentially help if there's, you know, a big powerful guardian from a different plane who's guarding.
Yeah. If it's a celestial elemental fey or fiend that's guarding Kuven.
Yeah.
And I could bring that fiend whatever to me. We'd kill it and then release Kuven.
Isn't it like you have to know its true name or something like that?
I think you guys have lots of options, and we're going to maybe do some research on our own here during the week as we figure out as the caravan continues. This is when your fortune teller says, it's time for me to go. Thank you all for your patronage. Would you mind getting this one off of my carriage, please? I can't take him with me. As Kuven's body, she goes over a bump, his head like bobs over to the other side.
I think we should waylay her and steal the 10,000 gold.
I was going to say, I also have access to Geis or Geis, the spell.
Uh-huh.
So I could place a magical command on this dude and have him release Kuven.
Good. If he fails the save, right?
Yeah.
And he can do the minute long cast.
All right.
Or it's a really long cast.
Except my wisdom's only a plus one, so that's it's probably going to save it.
The fortune teller's cart eventually disappears in a puff of smoke. Mm. As though leaving this plane. I'll say you took that warning to get Kuven's body out so he doesn't just poof, fall on the dusty ground as the caravan continues with its multiple carriages. You pass through the Gathering Stone, and as you see the Gaul River on the horizon, you can also see the large goblinoid capital of Rhukaan Draal. As you approach the city, with House Orien feeling like they have protected you along this trip. We're going to end our session here, guys. Thanks for playing. We're going to be back next week. I don't know if all of us will be here. I think, Luis, you weren't sure if you were here next week, or are you here next week?
No, I was originally planning this week, but things had to move around. So next week I'll be gone.
You'll be gone next round. All right. But the rest of us will be here. We'll see what happens. Thanks for playing. Thanks for digging deep into the deck of many things, everybody. And we'll see what happens next time. Bye. Later.